Now, having looked at what this principal agency relationship is all about, we've also looked at how to create it. We have also examined the issues that may are likely to arise from the creation of this relationship. We've also examined other similar relationships that may not necessarily be principal agent. Today, we'll be looking at the effects of contracts entered into by agents on behalf of their principal, as well as the rights and duties of agents and principal as well. And I gave an example of where maybe the principal may not have expressly authorized the agent to act in a particular manner, but he does act anyway but on behalf of the principal. What is the effect of such contracts entered into by them? So the key issues to be covered will include the effects of contracts made by agents. What happens when an agent commits a tort? Again, I gave an example of that in the course of carrying out the instructions of the principal, the agent could cause harm to a third party. What does that mean? What is the effect of that? We'll also look at types of agents, rights and duties of the agent, and termination of an agency relationship. Now, generally, when an agent enters into a contract on behalf of a named principal, so in this particular instance, the agent will indicate that Mr. A is the principal. Then he goes on to disclose to the third party that I'm acting as an agent. So one, the third party with whom he is acting on behalf of the principal knows the name of the principal. He knows that there is a principal involved. Then he also knows that the agent is not acting in his own personal capacity, but for somebody else known as Mr. A being the principal. When that happens, you find that the agent would not incur any liability. He will not benefit from any rights or any benefit. He would also not be personally held responsible to carry out any obligation, because the third party with whom he's acting was informed that he's only acting as an agent. He was also informed of who the principal is, and therefore the agent will not be personally held liable. So that in the event of a breach, the third party cannot bring an action against the agent in his personal capacity. He should bring an action against the principal as the person who authorized the agent, and the agent only acting as an agent for the principal. You can't sue the agent in his personal capacity, because you will not be held liable for his actions, but the principal would. But you find that there are instances where even though the agent may have informed the principal he's acting for a particular principal, he will now enter into a deed or the contract as a deed and sign it in his name. The moment he does that, the position changes, then he'll be held liable, because he signed a deed in his name, and therefore he can be held personally liable. Again, when he also signs a bill of exchange, we'll also be looking at what a bill of exchange is, an instrument. He signs a bill of exchange again in his name. Without disclosing that he signed as an agent, he would also be held liable. So these are the exceptions to that rule. And again, there are instances where the circumstances itself will indicate that if you look at the nature of the contract, look at the circumstances surrounding it, even though he had indicated I'm acting for this particular person, but you find that everything he's doing is for himself. So some of the circumstances itself may also make the agent personally liable and not the principal. And there are instances where a person could be an agent, but he may be in fact the principal himself. As particularly, when you take an example of a sole proprietorship, you know that for a sole proprietorship, the owner and the business are one and the same person. There's no difference. But it's a business anyway, it's a trading name. So the proprietor goes out to and sign or execute contracts in the name of the business. But in law, he and the business are one and the same person. So in this particular instance, even though he may be acting as an agent, he himself is the principal, because he owns the business as sole proprietor. So in this instance, even though he may have disclosed that he's acting for somebody else, being the sole proprietor, the business or the trading name, for instance, he can be held personally liable, because he and the business are one and the same, and therefore the agent in this instance and the principal are the same person. And there are also instances where, as a result of the peculiar trade custom of that particular business, even though the person may be an agent, in accordance with the custom of the business, he will still be held liable for the actions. What if the agent doesn't name the principal, but he discloses that he's acting as an agent? In the first instance, he indicated who the principal is. He also went on to disclose that he's acting as an agent. In this instance, even though he discloses that he's acting as an agent, he doesn't indicate the principal. And therefore, he may have acted for an unnamed principal, but he discloses the relationship. In this instance, he would also not be held liable for the obligations under the contract or for breach. What if he doesn't disclose the principal at all? He just goes and acts, but he knows it's for somebody, but doesn't disclose to the third party that he's acting for somebody. In that instance, he will be held liable for the obligations arising under the contract and for any breach. The agent will be held personally liable for that. There are instances where, again, in the course of carrying out the instructions of a principal, the agent may cause harm to a third party. For example, a principal, let's say, gives a catapult or a gun, for instance, to an agent to sell. Without knowing, either knowingly or unknowingly, the catapult or the gun was faulty. A third innocent third party buys it and sustains injury as a result of that. Or in the process of showing the third party how the catapult looks like, he sustains injuries. The question is, who will be responsible for the harm or for the pain that has been caused this third party? The position has been that both the agent and the principal will be jointly and severally held liable for the harm caused to this third party. We would now look at the types of agents. There's a universal agent, general agent, special agent. So look at, and the special agents have also different types. The Delcredit agent, broker, mercantile agent, a factor, and auctioneer. Factors and auctioneers are also types of mercantile agents. So look at what this means. Who is a universal agent? It's one who has unrestricted authority to contract on behalf of his principal, meaning that he's given open instructions, open authority. He can do anything under the authority granted him by the principal. There are no restrictions. And usually, because of the nature of such authority, it can only be created by a deed, which is a contract under seal. A deed is simply a contract under seal. That is what a deed is. Now, it is also quite rare. It is not very common. The next type of agent is a general agent. This type of agent has authority to represent his principal in all matters connected with a particular trade or particular business. Unlike a universal that can, you know, deal with all the businesses of the principal, with a general, the authority is given to his general because he's in all matters, but connected to only a particular trade or a particular business, but all matters regarding that particular trade. And that is what a general agent is. And a special agent, again, has powers to enter into transactions on behalf of a principal for a particular transaction, but has limited powers. Unlike the one with no restrictions, this one has to do with a particular transaction and also has limited powers to do a particular thing. An example of such special agents, what is called the Delcredit agent. This type of agent sells goods for extra commission. And for that extra commission, he undertakes the principal that he will pay if the purchaser fails to pay. So that is a type of a special agent. he's being authorized to sell the goods anyway for commission. But for undertaking that he will pay, if the person doesn't pay, he gets an extra commission for that undertaking. That's a debt credit agent. Then a broker. A broker is simply an agent who acts on behalf of parties, both the owner and a third party. He doesn't act for one particular party, but for both of them. He may sell or provide certain service on behalf of the parties, but for a fee. An example, there are a number of brokerage companies in Ghana, for instance. They, for instance, trade on the stock market. So a company may want to sell its shares or trade in its shares on the stock market. So the broker will trade, look for buyers and will sell to them. So you find that he asks for them. He usually asks for what is called a brokerage fee. He takes a fee. Sometimes they also take a commission. That's also a type of special agent. Then a mercantile agent. Again, it is one that in the ordinary course of business, he buys or sells or raises money on goods in his possession. The key thing, the mercantile agent always has possession of the goods. He can buy it or he sells. So specific types of goods that is authorized to trade in, he can buy and then he sells, all on behalf of the principal. Or he can also hold the goods in his possession to raise funds. He can use those goods as security to raise funds again on behalf of the principal. But he does that in the ordinary course of his business. That is what he does anyway. An example of this type of mercantile agent is a factor. A factor. And the factor again is one who sells goods delivered to him by the principal for some compensation. He also has possession of the goods. Another example is an auctioneer. You know, I think we hear the name auctioneers in our everyday lives. It is the person appointed by a person or a principal to sell goods at an auction. And usually when the goods are sold at an auction or by an auction, we say that the sale is complete upon the fall of a hammer. And he usually sells to the highest bidder unless he's instructed otherwise. So these are the types of agents. Now, having known the types of agents, the next issue to look or to examine is the duties and rights of agents and principal. What are they required to do? What are their respective obligations? What are their respective rights? We will look at the duties of agents first. They are mandated to obey all lawful instructions of the principal. So long as the instructions are lawful and falls within the confines of their instructions, they must obey them. For instance, the principal cannot instruct an agent to go and cause harm to somebody else. If a principal tells an agent, go and slap Mr. A, he can refuse to do so because that instruction is not lawful. It is against the law to go slapping people. So that is an unlawful instruction, and the agent is empowered to disobey that instructions. And the principal cannot hold him responsible or liable for disobeying. But if he refuses to comply with a lawful instruction, for instance, he's been authorized to go and sell a car at the price of 90,000 cedis, and he goes to sell it at 60,000 without any further variation from the principal, that will not be obeying a lawful instruction. Or if he were asked to park the car at site B for purpose of selling, and he goes to park it at site C, that would also not be obeying a lawful instruction, and he can't be held liable for that. He must also exercise due care and skill in the performance of his duty. Of course, he must make sure that whatever he's doing, he doesn't cause harm. He acts in utmost good faith. He must also render accounts. He must also avoid conflict of interest. If, for instance, he himself is selling cars, let's say Mercedes-Benz cars, and he goes to take the same Mercedes-Benz cars from the principal to sell, when people come to buy, which of the cars is he going to sell? So the question, he must at all times, of course, avoid conflict of interest. But if he discloses to the principal, then that would be an exception, that I'm selling the same type of car and the principal has no problem with that, then that is okay. So long as there's a disclosure, then that it is okay. But otherwise, he must at all times avoid conflict of interest, and it's his duty to also make profit for the principal, but not to make profit beyond his commission or remuneration. He cannot take anything that has not been given to him. Any profit he makes must go back to the principal. He can only take his commission, but not make profit, personal profit, beyond his commission or remuneration that the principal must pay him. He must also not delegate his authority. He must not do so without prior consent or authorization of the principal. And this consent authorization could either be expressed or implied. Again, there are also instances where he simply cannot help it. The nature of the facts are such that he has to delegate. In that instance, it will be acceptable. Or unless maybe the delegation is necessary for proper performance. For instance, he's been appointed to or authorized to build a house. For instance, he cannot go carry the concrete himself. He cannot be seen to be laying the blocks himself. He cannot do the painting himself. So inbuilt in the instructions is also a responsibility or the right to delegate some of the responsibilities. He can't be doing everything by it. So sometimes the circumstances is such that he has to delegate anyway. So either with the consent authorization of the principal, or it is such that he has to delegate, or the trade custom also allows him to delegate, then he can delegate. In the absence of that, he cannot delegate the instructions without the prior consent authorization of the principal. What happens when the agent also breaches any of the duties? The principal can dismiss him summarily. Summarily means that without giving him a hearing, without asking him what happened, he can just ask him to go. That's a summary dismissal. He can also claim any profit, secret profit, the agent may have made. Remember, we said that he cannot make any profit beyond his commission. If he does, he needs to disclose it to the principal. And if the principal is happy, he can consent to that. If not, he doesn't disclose, and then he makes some secret profit, the principal can also claim all those, terminate it, and then claim the profits back. Or he can decide to claim the profit and not terminate. That is the, it's left to the principal to decide whether he wants to terminate, he wants to dismiss him, or he only wants to claim the secret profit made. He can also refuse to pay the agent the agreed commission and then recover any or all commission paid to him. Then he can also repudiate the contract within a reasonable time. So these are the remedies that are available to the principal in the event of a breach of duty by the agent. Again, depending on the nature of the breach, the principal could exercise all or any of these remedies. Now let's look at the rights of an agent. The agent has a right to a commission or remuneration. He must be paid for the work he does. He cannot do the work using his own energy, his own services, and sometimes even at his own cost without a payment. So once the parties have agreed on a certain remuneration, certain wage or certain commission, he must be paid that commission or that remuneration. He also has a right to indemnity. Remember that when we looked at the different types of agents, we also see that sometimes when he acts in a particular manner, the principal will be held liable. In those instances where the principal is held liable, the principal must take steps and put the agent in his proper position if somebody brings an action against him and he's held liable to pay. So assuming that in the process of acting for the principal, an action accrues to a third party who brings an action against him and then he wins. Remember that we said where he causes harm to a third party, both principal and agent will be joint and severally liable, for instance. So assuming that the court awards damages against both principal and agent, so long as the agent was acting in the course of his instructions, the principal must pay him that portion that he's supposed to pay as a result of the award of the court. So he must indemnify the agent against any loss or damage that he may suffer in the course of carrying out his instructions. The agent also has a right to a lien over the goods. Again, while the principal fails to pay the agent and he's in possession of the goods belonging to the principal, he can hold on to it. That's a right of lien. He holds on to it until the principal pays him. What about the principal? What are some of his duties? Again, he must pay the agent's commission. Just like the agent has a right to a commission, the principal must pay that commission or remuneration that the agent is entitled to. He must, it's his duty to also indemnify the agent, as we discussed earlier, and he must also give precise instructions. If the instructions are not precise, if they are not certain, if they are not clear, but they are rather incomplete and unambiguous, then the agent may not, and I'm using my words, I said may, I didn't say would not or shall not, the agent may not be held liable for his actions. And therefore, at all time, instructions given by the principal must be clear, must be precise, they must be certain. They should not be ambiguous, they should not be uncertain, and they should not be imprecise. Just like the agent, the principal also has rights. The principal can also bring an action and sue the agent for damages for breach of the contract, especially where the agent fails to carry out his instructions or in accordance with the contract entered into. The principal can sue him for breach. He can also sue him for damages for negligence. Under negligence, there are three key things that a person must always establish: the duty, breach, and damage. If under the contract between the principal and then the agent owed the principal a duty to carry out his specific instructions, and he failed to do so as a result of negligence, he did not take care, and as a result of not taking care, he caused harm, and then the principal maybe suffered some damages, the principal can bring an action against the agent for damages as a result of the negligence, which, as I said, there must be a duty owed to the principal, there must be a breach of that duty. As a result of that breach, he must suffered some damage. The principal can also sue for secret fraud. Again, remember that we said that the agent cannot make profit beyond what he's supposed to be paid, and if he does, he must disclose it to the principal. If he does it and he makes secret profit, the principal can also sue him for the refund of that secret profit. He also has a right to revoke the authority that he has given the agent. So that brings us to the end of our discussion on the rights and duties of principal and agent. We've looked at how this relationship is created, what are their respective rights and obligations, and all that, and the effect of a contract entered into by them. The next issue, how do you bring this relationship to an end? How can you bring this into an end after creating it? Now, there are two main ways by which a principal and agent can terminate this principal agency relationship. The one main way is by the acts of the parties. The parties by themselves can bring this relationship to an end, and they can do that by mutual agreement. They can mutually agree that will bring this relationship to an end. Or the principal may give notice to the agent that he's revoking that authority he has given him. Or he may also renounce the authority that given him by the principal. So the principal can revoke the authority given the agent, and the agent can renounce the authority the principal has also given him. By doing any of these, it will bring the relationship to an end. The second way is by operation of law. In this instance, it is not as a result of the conduct of the parties or any act of the parties, but it's because the law says so. An example is where the principal or the agent dies. Remember that this relationship is between one person and the other. So if one person is no longer there, the other person cannot say that I am acting on behalf of another. Assuming the agent also died, the principal cannot say that the agent is acting for me when he's dead. So once either party dies or both of them die, that relationship comes to an end. Insanity, when either of the parties is also declared insane. So therefore, can say by reason of insanity, the relationship automatically comes to an end. Bankruptcy of the principal. When the principal also becomes bankrupt, he declares it, he files it, and is accepted, then that's the end of the story. That also brings that relationship to an end. Then any illegality. For instance, a contract with today may be lawful, may tomorrow, by reason of a certain law passed, may become illegal. When that happens, automatically that relationship also comes to an end. A classic example, assuming that in some countries prostitution is legal. In Ghana, so far as I'm concerned, it's still illegal. But let's assume, but I hope it will never come to that. Tomorrow, Parliament passes a law and says that it is legal. Or today, it is illegal, so it's legal, and then tomorrow they say it's illegal. Then any contract that has been entered into prior to that becomes illegal, and therefore they cannot be doing that. Completion of assigned duties. If at the end, whatever the agent has been asked to do, he's done it, he's come to the end of it, and that's it. Automatically, the contract itself expires, so it will bring that relationship to an end. If, again, besides completing the duties, if there's also time stated in the contract itself, then upon the expiration of that time, then automatically, and by operation of law, that relationship also comes to an end. Assuming they enter into a 5-year contract, the moment the 5-year ends, automatically that's the end of it. Or by frustration, or what it's also known as acts of God. Assuming that as a result of floods, the entire warehouse of the principal is destroyed, that is the end of it. So that would also be said to have frustrated by an act of God being. But I always say that in Ghana, the floods we have are not acts of God, it's acts of man. But in certain countries, it's an act of God. So as a result of that frustration, that relationship automatically also comes to an end. Now, what are the rights and duties of an agent? And then how is an agency relationship terminated? I expect you to also try your hands and answer these questions using the issues that we have discussed and some of the cases that were also indicated. You also need to read those cases and find out how the court dealt with the issues arising.